Hey guys, my name is Amy Jane and welcome back to my channel. This is part two of a series titled The Truth About Cholesterol. If you haven't already, go check out part one of the series where I talk about cholesterol myths, the dangers of cholesterol-lowering drugs like statins, and my dietary recommendations. That will be linked below in the description box as well as at the end of this video. I'm a registered dietitian, and in today's video, I'm briefly going to discuss the flaws of cholesterol research and how we got it all wrong. As I'm sure you know, we have warned Americans since the 1960s that dietary cholesterol is bad. We were taught that it will raise your blood cholesterol, which will create plaque in your arteries, and therefore increase your risk for a heart attack or stroke. But how did this idea that dietary cholesterol is bad actually start in the first place? In 1913, there was a Russian pathologist named Nikolaj Anitschkow who was experimenting with cholesterol on animals. And he reported that feeding rabbits mega doses of cholesterol induced atherosclerotic type lesions, or plaque. This led to the widespread view that cholesterol in the diet, such as in eggs, must cause atherosclerosis, or heart disease. To test his theory, this exact experiment was widely replicated on a variety of animals, including cats, sheep, cattle, and horses. However, I want to point out one big problem in this experiment. Rabbits, along with most other animals used in the experiments, are all inherently herbivores, so they don't normally eat animal food and therefore are not biologically designed to metabolize cholesterol. When the experiment was replicated on dogs, who were designed to eat meat, as humans are, hence the canine, they demonstrated an ability to regulate an extreme intake of cholesterol. Animal trials will never be as useful as human trials, but the canine comparison is a much better model for humans. Yet, the rabbit experiment was the only research that actually made it to the public, which created the fear of cholesterol in our society. I also want to mention that the cholesterol used in the rabbit experiment was dissolved in vegetable oil and therefore was not how it is found naturally. So this experiment does not show us a true comparison to eating an egg or any other natural food product containing cholesterol. Ansel Keys, who was seen as a nutrition pioneer in his day, heard about these rabbit experiments and did some testing himself, but with humans. And he found that no matter how much cholesterol he gave the participants in the study, the cholesterol levels in the blood remained unchanged. He found that adding dosages of cholesterol upwards of 3,000 milligrams per day, so similar to the amount found in about 15 eggs, had only a trivial effect on blood cholesterol. Many other studies have actually reinforced this conclusion as well. In one case, a Swedish doctor named Ulf Ravenskov upped his consumption of eggs from 1 to 8 per day for a week straight and discovered that his total cholesterol level actually went down. Next, let's talk about the Framingham Study. This study had a huge impact on why the dietary guidelines for Americans decided to officially tell the public to restrict dietary cholesterol. Findings from the Framingham study first appeared to correlate blood cholesterol to coronary atherosclerosis. However, 30 years later, in the Framingham follow-up study, this proved to be untrue. Because 30 more years had gone by, investigators had more data because a greater number of participants had passed on, and therefore we could study what they died from. And it turned out that the correlation of total cholesterol to heart disease was very weak. For reference, currently the field of medicine defines blood cholesterol levels of less than 200 milligrams per deciliter normal and healthy. In this study, men and women with cholesterol between 205 and 264 showed no relationship to heart disease. In fact, half of the people who had heart attacks had cholesterol levels below the normal level. In men aged 48 to 57, those with cholesterol in the mid-range of 183 to 222 had a greater risk of heart attack death than those with higher cholesterol ranging from 222 to 261 milligrams per deciliter. This shows us that total cholesterol did not turn out to be a reliable predictor for heart disease after all. The MRFIT study is another that greatly affected our nutrition recommendations to lower cholesterol in the diet. This study was done in the 1970s and afterwards published a graph to demonstrate cholesterol levels and mortality over the course of 6 years. However, our recommendations to lower cholesterol in the diet were based off of only part of the chart, while ignoring very other important findings. At first, the chart seems to obviously point to high cholesterol as the culprit, but let's take a deeper look. Remember that what medicine defines as normal and healthy blood cholesterol levels are anything less than 200 milligrams per deciliter. The chart shows that all-cause mortality is the same from cholesterol ranging from 152 to 250 milligrams per deciliter. Notice the striking increase in all-cause mortality at the lowest level of cholesterol. And finally, notice how total cholesterol has nothing to do with the chance of dying from a stroke. So while some people did indeed have a higher risk of heart attack at certain cholesterol levels, This shows us that simply keeping our cholesterol levels below 200, which is our current medical recommendation, does not significantly decrease our risk for heart disease. Who's to say what really caused these heart events? I would love to see this exact graph done depicting the participants' sugar consumption and other variables like their activity level and smoking. There are plenty of studies out there showing that what we consider high cholesterol actually decreases heart disease risk and health issues. For example, I came across a study that found people with the highest cholesterol levels had the best memory. And on the other hand, another study concluded that people with low cholesterol had higher rates of depression, aggression, and suicidal thoughts. And these are just two of many studies that challenge our current beliefs on blood cholesterol levels and restrictions. There are hundreds of research papers that never made it to the public spotlight that conclude cholesterol may not be the bad guy, and in fact might be protective. As always, please don't just take my word for it. I've given you a quick blurb or summary, but go read these studies or research papers for yourself. Any studies I mentioned are listed in the description box below, and I also listed a couple books that really opened my eyes to the bigger picture of cholesterol. Again, if you haven't already, go check out part one of the series linked below, and stay tuned for my next video in the series where I will explain why LDL cholesterol is not a reliable blood test to determine heart disease risk. In that video, I will provide you with a list of blood tests that are much better indicators for heart disease. If you enjoy this type of content and want to see more, let me know by liking this video and subscribing. And if you have any questions on the subject, please leave them in the comments below. Thanks for stopping by, and I will see you next time.